Salaam alaikum and welcome to Beneath the Surface. Today we'll be discussing job bias in the UK. And joining us today on the show is Baroness Jenny Tung, who was a Liberal Democrat Member of Parliament. Thank you very much for joining us today. We'll start off with, in the UK, you would imagine because of the democracy here that when someone is to be employed, the employer wouldn't actually think of, you know, they wouldn't regard the person according to their colour or faith. However, in the UK, there are many reports stating that that is the case, that some males and females would actually have to change their name to an English name, and some females would actually have to take off their hijab because, you know, they want to be employed. Do you think, why do you think that is, first?
I think there's a certain fear at the moment of employing somebody who isn't English and speaks English fluently. I mean, that's the basic fear. But before I say any more, it makes me smile slightly because my husband's name was Tong when he was a teenager without an E. And they used to have requests, if they were applying for university or anything, to send a photograph because people assumed they were Chinese, which they weren't, they're English. And so they put an E on the end of their name to prove to people that they weren't Chinese. It's always happened, and I suspect it happens in a lot of countries, that people are always suspicious of not their own kind. But it is quite outrageous what is happening in this country, because we have got many, many different ethnic groups, many different religions. I'm proud of that. I think that's the most wonderful thing about this country, is the mixture we've got. They're all British people. They all should be treated equally. And I think there is a law that says employers shouldn't discriminate, but of course they do, very quietly.
But with this, as you said, like with the multicultural nation, don't you think that suspicion should have kind of like decreased?
Yes, but it's difficult to legislate against suspicion. You know, people are naturally cautious of people they don't feel they know very well, don't know the culture of. So you have to accept that they're cautious. I mean, I'm sure that in let's say an Arab country, if an ordinary British family went to live there and tried to get employment, there might be a little bit of caution as to, you know, whether they would speak the language properly, whether they would know the culture properly, what purpose were they there for. So I think, you know, you have to remember it does happen in both ways, but it's broken down hugely. I mean, you look in the health service where I used to work, we are totally dependent on ethnic minorities in the health service. If people from ethnic minority communities left this country, we would have very little health service. What would the post offices do? What would the banks do? What would the teaching profession do? I mean, people are integrated now in a way that they've never ever been before. And it's happened in a very short time since the Second World War, you know. When I was a little girl, just after the Second World War, there were hardly any ethnic minorities at all in this country. It's only 60 years. And now we have a huge, and I think very vibrant and colourful mix of people. And yes, there are still problems. There are still problems. But you've got to overcome those.
How do you think they can actually overcome them?
I think you have to challenge the person. And there are things called employment tribunals. I mean, there are people you can actually challenge to say, why did you not shortlist me? I mean, if you are not shortlisted for something, you can always ask why. If you don't succeed at an interview, you can always ask why and ask them to actually give a breakdown as to where you went wrong. Things like wearing the hijab and wearing any sort of, I mean, there was a case recently, do you remember with British Airways, that a lady wasn't allowed to wear a cross
Yes.
with her uniform because no jewellery was allowed with the uniform. I think that's all, I think this is all a bit ridiculous, you know, I don't know what they're about. If it's a danger, then that's a different thing altogether. I mean, it's a big dangling chain piece of jewellery that might be a danger. But it seems to me that particularly in the health service, they always allow hijabs because actually it's more hygienic than having hair flowing about all over the place. So I don't think you get discriminated against in the health service for hijab. Have you heard any reports?
Not in the health service, no, but it's mainly in like the business sectors and in schools and stuff recently because of the situation, I imagine, in the Middle East, they've become more cautious
People think that because terrible things are happening in the Middle East, anyone who is of Middle Eastern origin must be must be dangerous. That is ludicrous, absolutely ludicrous. And any intelligent person knows that. But, you know, I would challenge you. There are a lot of people in the public services. If you go into the tax offices, the insurance offices, the British government, passport, all of those, there's people from ethnic minorities working in all of them and working very well and are very, very valuable and intelligent people.
That's true. But then with the recession, when employers had to kind of, you know, tell people that they can't work for them anymore, it was mainly the ethnic minorities that were let down before.
Have you got the statistics on that? Because I think it's young people who suffer most of all, isn't it?
It was the
of
young
all,
people.
Of all groups, it's
That's
young
true,
people
because
have
of
a
the,
terrible
the
time.
The experience that they
is
don't
they have.
Have
no experience. I think if you're well educated and well qualified, you can still actually win through.
But with that, just, you know, on the youngsters, like when we finish our university degrees and everything, how can we actually get the experience before that job?
I mean, that is a good point, because in England recently we've encouraged many, many people to go to university. And sometimes they've gone to university and done courses that didn't actually lead to anything. And I think that's the problem. And it's okay if you can afford to just go to university for the joy of it, for the pure education, you know, do classics or something, and maybe become a teacher of classics or whatever jobs are available there. But I think there have been a lot of courses created in the universities to encourage people to stay on in education that haven't really benefited people very much. I mean, I think, for instance, media studies. There's loads and loads of young people of my children's generation who did media studies, and there's a limited number of jobs, you know.
It's not just a limited number of jobs, the minimum experience you need to have.
Yeah, and you have to work to nothing. You have to volunteer and do things like that, do you?
That is the problem. Yeah. And it's like, how do you expect me to, you know, live if I'm just doing voluntary work and stuff?
Yes, yes.
So do you think they can, the government can
do
something about
that? I appreciate the problem,
that?
But I mean, that's what benefits are all about, and that's what the job creation schemes are all about. And that's why now I believe, I'm not an expert on this, by the way, it's not my field, but if you go to a job centre now, they try and find you something suited to your qualifications, or direct you to another, to a course or something else you could do. Or I think if all of that fails, you have to take the first job that comes up. Is that not true?
That is true, because there came a time where I was unemployed myself, and I took that route. And to be honest, it was more difficult than just being at home and not working, because it's like you would keep trying and trying and trying to get a job.
It's
However, because
totally
of
demoralising.
It really is, because it's like, you know, you tried, you worked as hard as you possibly can to try and get a job, but then you didn't get a job in the end. And however many times you would be, you know, sending out your CV and going to interviews, it's harder than it actually should be, I believe. And it's just not just that. It's like with the job centre itself, the way that you have to go in every week and stuff and sign, I don't believe it kind of helps as much, because it's not actually allowing someone to get the job they believe they need, or even to get a job. And it's,
but you see, if the jobs aren't there, you can't get a job. And this has been the problem with the recession, that everything failed. This has happened all over Europe. Yeah. I've got friends who live in France, and that the employment situation in France is far, far worse than it is here. And it's just a matter of waiting until the economy picks up again. And it is beginning to pick up in this country. But in the meantime, I know that people have to do some pretty menial jobs. One of my family actually is a great young man, and he always says there's no such thing as unemployment. You can always do something if you're not proud.
That is true, but it's not just
and
that.
And he says, it's probably more difficult for women, but he says even the most menial tasks and the jobs that he's done to fill in time, he's learnt something. And he says that's useful. I've either learnt something about a job or a place or the people I was working with, and that's all good experience that I can put on my CV and build up, you know, my personal experience of things. So I think sometimes people are a bit too picky and choosy about what they want to do and are not prepared to do anything in the meantime.
Yeah, that is a bit of a problem, but it's not just that. Like for the taxpayer, for example, how much do they need to take from the taxpayer in order to pay, you know, the people that are unemployed?
Yes, well, so there's been cuts recently, haven't there? I mean,
there's been a lot of cuts, which the people on benefits are not able to manage, and even the people who are working are not managing with, you know,
look,
the net
price. Look, if you set me off on this sort of tack, I would tell you that I think our government has taken a totally wrong decision, which means that we don't tax rich people. The rationale for that is that the rich people, you know, the chief executives and all these people who are bankers who earn huge amounts of money, 173 times more than the average worker, 173 times. It never used to be that differential between salaries. But they don't tax them because they say, oh, they'd go elsewhere and we would lose their expertise and we have to compete with America and other countries. Now, I just think that is a nonsense argument. I think it's the rich making the rich richer all the time.
Yeah.
And one of the terrible things that's happening in this country is that the gap between the rich and the poor is widening all the time, and the recession has made that worse. But there's only another 6 months to go of this government. You never know. The next government might be a little bit better.
Yeah.
But the economy has to pick up. And a lot of rich people have got to accept that they need to pay more taxes.
But then that's really discriminating in the sense that why should, you know, middle class or working class have to pay taxes if the rich isn't? The rich have enough money to you know, have a living, whereas
Absolutely.
The working class, for example, can barely manage.
Yeah,
they will
I agree.
Be, you know, in a shared
home. But I mean,
home.
You're talking socialism, you know, and sharing equally.
It's not just sharing equally.
Not like sharing equally, but, you know, giving each person according to their need. And I entirely agree with you. It's just you've got to get the British people to work for that and to vote for that in the next election.
Hopefully and, they won't.
Well, hope they will. And I hope, too, that people in the ethnic minorities, and I do hate that phrase because, you know, we're all British now.
Yes.
We should pass it. But I hope that everyone will vote. I mean, there was a brilliant example in Scotland during that referendum that they gave the vote to 16-year-olds. And actually they had, what was it, an 85% turnout of the vote for the Scottish referendum. Now, in general elections in this country, we get 60% or something like that. You know, it's appalling that people live in a democracy. They don't appreciate that they're in a democracy and they can change it. You really can change it. You know, if you get in there and start voting in great enough numbers, you will get the sort of representation that you want and it will change government policy. But people think, oh, they can't be bothered, you know. Not.
But there are many different ways in voting. Sometimes
and we need
you can
more women
post.
In politics, can I say that?
Of course.
We need a lot more women, and we need a lot more women like you in politics. We've got some really, really good women in the House of Commons at the moment from the ethnic minorities. You know, I think of people like Yasmin Qureshi and Debbie Abrahams, and she's not really ethnic minority, I don't know what she'd classify herself as, but you know, they all speak up and they're really, really good people. And there's a lawyer, there's, you know, there's all sorts of good women in the House of Commons, not pale white middle class, you know, people from all sorts of backgrounds, and that's what we need to encourage. And it's people like you and your friends that need to get stuck in.
How would we be able to take that step, do you think?
By getting interested in politics and joining a political party. Now, it doesn't matter which, I'm not promoting one political party or another. look at all the political parties, think of the one that suits you best, whether it's the Green Party or whether it's UKIP at the other end of the scale, which is a bit of a joke, but you know, they are the, and then there's Conservative, Labour, Liberal Democrat, which was my party, all in between. Find a party that most agrees with the sort of things you want and get active locally. That's what I did. I mean, I'm a lady doctor, but I didn't just get sort of swung into politics. I got active locally on the Parent Teacher Association. Then I joined my local political branch. Then I got active in the local council and became a local councillor. And then when the general election came along, I thought, hey, I'm going to have a go for Parliament. So I got into Parliament. I got elected in the end. So, and that was from the grassroots. And women have a huge advantage. Huge advantage, because unlike men, they use all the public services and they meet so much more people. If you think that the, you know, a woman marries, she has children, she knows all about the schools the children go to and the problems there are, she knows about school meals and nutrition, she knows about the health service, because women have to attend the health service far more than anybody else. All of those things mean that women are much better qualified to represent us in Parliament than the men are, who just go off to their jobs, or some of them actually don't even go off to jobs, they go straight into politics after university, and they've never done anything else. That's one of the problems today, is there are so many people leading us who've never had jobs, they've never done anything.
That is a problem. But speaking about women, there's been a lot of studies as well saying that employees don't actually employ women because she's going to get married and she's going to get children. And that's why we have more male in with employment other than women. Don't you think that problem should have been over and done with?
Well, you know, it has to a certain extent. I mean, I was employed in the health service and I had three children. I mean, it is up to the woman to decide where her priorities are and what she's going to do. We can't help having babies. Women have babies. But there are two issues. One is, I think, as a woman's health doctor, we should have total control over our own bodies. So we only have the number of children we want. And if we're a woman who wants a career too, and to get a good job, maybe we'll want to stop at just two children or three children. But a woman should be in control. It's the woman who should choose and decide how many children she wants. That's one thing, terribly important, and she should have good health care and good contraceptive services and good, you know, so that she can decide. Mm-hmm. Having done that, when she's got children, we have to make sure that the government provides good childcare, and it has to be affordable childcare. Because the only way some women can work is to take their child to a day nursery or a childminder or something. Now, the last government, the Labour government, made great strides on that, actually. But this government, they say it's the recession's fault, but they actually cut back on that. That is something the next government has got to address. But it's up to women to really shout up about it. We've really got to be firm and say, look, if you look all around the world, now you're onto my pet subject now. If you look all around the world, the developing countries that have gone fastest, whose economies have got better and their standard of living have got better, are all the countries who have given women good health care and family planning services at the very beginning. So they have been able by choice to have fewer children and be healthier. Because there's nothing healthy about having 7, 8, 9, 10 children. It wears you out. I had three, and it, you know, that was enough for me. But they've done that. They've given women really good health services. Women have decided, okay, my good childcare service, my children are going to live, they're going to be all right. I want to get them properly educated. And that means that you have fewer people, smaller families, the women can go out to work, and the country gets richer.
Which is beneficial for both sides.
Beneficial for both sides, and it makes the men's wallets fatter too, which they like. So, and this has been proven, and it's the World Bank, you know, all of those big international organisations has proved this now. They've done the graphs, they've done the statistics. So actually the key to any sort of human development and jobs and prosperity and a good standard of living is looking at your women and giving them all the things they need, which is good healthcare, the right to run their own bodies and not have people demand things of them, and also, of course, some childcare if they need it. Now, some families don't need it. I mean, I was very lucky. My mother used to help me tremendously when I was working. So, but you know, it depends on the family situation. But that's what you need. And any politician worth his salt knows that if you invest in those basic things for women, your country will take off.
If you're a mother, the chances of her getting a job is reduced by 70%. How can we, as you know, females, change that?
Well, if you're a mother and you're unemployed, you should be able to have time to join in what's happening in your community. And that's what I mean about getting active in the community and getting political and forming groups, forming women's groups, so that you can actually put pressure on your local representatives, whether it's the local council, who need to be providing childcare and nursery school places so that you can go out to work, or whether it's the MP, who needs to be doing something about creating more jobs and also making sure that women are not discriminated against, particularly women from the ethnic minorities.
But I just remembered there was, when they the government decided to stop the clubs that were taking place after school.
The Sure Start and things like that.
Yeah, and and minimise the clubs and the libraries that you know, we had everywhere in the UK.
Yeah.
That created a really big problem, which made everyone go out to the streets. If they were single mothers, if there were people in universities, like, and that didn't change the government's mind in any way. So what else can we do?
One of the things I did when I was a young mother with two babies, long, long time ago now, I hadn't had my third child, I formed a mother and toddler group in the local church because we had no childcare services whatsoever. So I actually formed one. Now, there is no reason why groups of people can't get together to do that.
But if they don't have
the place, friends,
if they don't have the place available, like before they had centres, they had different...
You've got churches empty most of the week, mosques empty most of the day. There must be places in the mosques, the women's rooms, all of those places, the synagogues, you know, whatever there is. There are always empty spaces somewhere in the community not being used, particularly religious buildings. And most of the Church of England and the Methodists, you know, the Christian establishments, will take other groups. You know, they're not. You don't have to be a Christian to use a Christian church for a meeting. They gladly have you meet in their hall. So, you know, I'm just saying a little bit of self-help sometimes. And I think that women like me in Britain are a sort of a few years ahead, a few decades ahead. When my grandmother was married, that was it. She just had child after child after child. That's my grandmother. It's not so long ago. She couldn't do anything about controlling the number of children she had. They just came. She did nothing. She did nothing at all. When my mother and her sisters were born, my grandmother made sure that they were all educated. She didn't want them to have the life that she'd had. And so my mother and her sisters were not only educated because of my grandmother's enthusiasm, but they were able to control the number of children they had as well, because family planning was creeping in and it was becoming more acceptable. Women were becoming more dominant and women were getting more rights. I mean, again, my grandmother had no rights. She couldn't have a bank account. She couldn't own a house. Everything had to go via her husband. When I got married in 1964, I was not allowed to be considered for a mortgage. With, together with my husband, they would not take my salary into account. And I was a doctor, because they said, oh no, we can't do that because you'll have babies. So we can't count your salary. Now, you see what I mean?
That's very surprising.
Yeah. And I didn't get a job. I remember going for one job interview, again in the early 60s, for a doctor, as a doctor in a hospital. And they asked what I was going to do between now and when the job starts. And I said, flippantly, oh, I'm getting married, actually. And I remember their faces just going...
They weren't too happy.
I didn't get the job. And I was told afterwards, some years afterwards, when I went back to that hospital and worked in another job, why on earth did you say that at the interview? Because so-and-so and so-and-so would never employ a married woman because they just have babies, they're no good.
But wouldn't they consider her getting married after, though?
Yes. Well, they do now. All doctors are married, male and female. Junior doctors, they all get married. They don't have to live in the hospital anymore. We had to live in like nuns. You know, we just had a single room to live in while we were doing that hospital doctor job. They don't do that anymore. They have shifts and they work outside and they live with their families. What I'm trying to say is, don't get too depressed. What's happening amongst your group at the moment is not so bad, but it is a lesser extent of what we were discriminated against in very, very similar ways. I was at medical school with 120 people in my year, and there were 10 women, that's all. I was one of 10 women.
That number is very surprising.
Yeah.
When you see how many doctors, female doctors.
Exactly. Nowadays, there are more women medical students than men. Yeah. Because women are getting better results, better education results. And that's the key for us, actually. I hope none of the men are listening, but the key for us is to be better than them.
That is the key.
We really have to be better.
But then with the whole change in like before, as you mentioned your grandmother, that was expected of a woman. Now that's changed. Like there are many males that stay in the home and the wife would go out to work,
yes,
for example.
All that can happen too.
That is kind of like happening, yes, these days. And yes, other than that, you would find also when a female, you know, gives birth, the male would also help. It's not just dependent on her. Mm. So wouldn't the employees think of that as well? Like if a male is married,
well,
they're going to get married.
They will gradually. They will, but give them time, you see. Men take a long time to change their mindset. They're lovely. I love men. But, you know, they've been fixed in this rigid role of being the boss, the wage earner, the controller. The women are under their care, you know, the carer. And they're great and they're wonderful at it, most of them. Not all of them, but they are. But you've got to gradually change the mindset. I mean, I see in my children's generation the men doing far more domestic chores than my husband ever did. They look after the children. I mean, my daughters-in-law actually go out and leave the children with their husband. I wouldn't have done that. He wouldn't have known what to do.
That's the thing. That's
and
what
it's
I mean by
all
the change.
Changing. It's all changing. But we mustn't be too impatient. But on the other hand, we mustn't stop trying and keep pushing the agenda so that in the end, men and women truly are treated equally. And we aren't asked, how many children have you got, if you go to a job interview. That's your affair, not their affair. If you're going for that job, you're going to guarantee that you do that job properly and well, however many children you've got. You have to remember that. And so does a man. You know, he should have the same responsibility.
He should, and you would expect
that. Yes,
he
should. And of course he doesn't. But it will come.
He doesn't. I would have agreed, like, when we are looking back in time, but these days there is that change, that hopeful change.
Yes.
But sadly, in the workplace, that isn't the case. Like, when you see the salary that the male gets and the salary that the female gets, you're just surprised because there's still that really big gap.
There's huge improvement on that, though.
To a certain extent.
Things never happen overnight.
Of course.
They always happen gradually. And equal pay for equal work is something that was brought in by the Labour government. And I know on the ground it's not happening completely.
That's
everywhere.
That's what I was just going to say.
But people, you know, and I suppose because of the recession and because of the fear of unemployment, women are afraid to take their employers to task about this and say, hey, I should be getting as much money as him. And because she doesn't want to lose her job. But it will get better. And I'm sorry, I'm an old woman. It's your generation that have got to keep fighting for these things
of
now.
Of course.
You know, and not let it slip back, because we had a lot of fights for things too.
Hopefully, like, we'll keep trying to, you know, resolve that problem, because sometimes when you think about it, the female, when we look at statistics, the female in education, she does, you know, better than a male by a lot, you know, and many more females go into education, unlike males, so you would expect them to be treated equally when it comes to pay. If not, the female should get paid even more, because, you know, like, she's the one, main
you
one
would,
that's going to be
and
taking
it will
care
happen
of the
eventually,
child.
But we have to accept too, as women, that we are the ones that have the uterus and the means to feed a baby. We're the ones that, you know, unless we can one day get pregnant and hand over the tiny little embryo to a special nursery who will grow it, you know, we are going to have the babies. Physically, we are going to have the babies, and we're going to have to nurture those babies and feed them in the early stages. We have to think of that, and we have to gear our lives to that. I remember my father saying to me, he was a great feminist, actually, my father. He was a school teacher, and he used to say, you must go to university, you must do all of the things, you must. And I used to say, well, you don't go on to the boys like this. He said, no, because the boys have got all the time in the world to accomplish what they want to do. They'll have no interruptions. But I know, whatever you say, that you're going to have babies one day, and that will interrupt your career at some stage. So you've got to get yourself as well qualified and as experienced as you possibly can before you have babies. Now, a lot of women are actually doing this now, if you notice, because the average age of women having babies in this country has gone up and up and up and up. It used to be early 20s, late teens, early 20s. And I had my first baby when I was 28. That's quite late in those days. But now it's more like 38 that people are having babies. I'm not so happy about that as someone who's worked in women's health all her life. I'm not so happy. I think people are better having babies when they're young. But you have to accept that there's going to be a bit of a blip while you have them.
But with that, like, sometimes I feel that we females have either, you know, their career choice or their family choice, because when you're saying that it's late 30s,
you can have both.
But then,
but you maybe won't become prime minister or the chief executive of Goldman Sachs. You know, you may not get up there that high. I think people talk a lot about glass ceilings for women.
Yes.
And I think quite often that glass ceiling is a woman's own aspiration, that she wants to get so far because she knows she can't do it all and have her children as well being her prime responsibility. I think that's what happens at the moment.
But health-wise, it's very bad for a woman to get pregnant at an older age. Has that changed? Has the health...
I think it's much better now than it used to be. It's more difficult to get pregnant when you're older. But I think as far as having a healthy baby, it's not that much different. There is a tiny increased chance of fetal abnormalities, you know, like Down syndrome and things like that, in an older woman. But that can be detected anyway when the woman's pregnant. So she doesn't have to necessarily go through with pregnancy. She doesn't want if the baby is very handicapped or disabled in some way, but that's another issue, and people feel differently about things like that. But I think women have to accept that there are certain restrictions on our lives because we are the main bearers and carers of children. However we work it out, I don't think that's going to change very much because of our emotions, because of our hormones. You know, I've seen women who say, I want to have my children quickly and then get right back to work. And they have their children and they have their maternity leave. Then they say, but I don't want to go back yet. I can't bear the thought of leaving him or leaving her.
Yeah.
You know? So we do have that to battle with. But it's not impossible. I've had quite a good life in all sorts of ways. And I've had three children. And I haven't been hugely rich. And I haven't employed expensive childcare. Most of my life started once my children were teenagers. That's when I really got going. Because at that time I felt it was more, you know, I could leave them and They were safer, well, perhaps not teenagers, when they're a little bit older. But that's when I went into Parliament, when my youngest child was quite old.
Do you think it would be like better for the female if the work provided a childcare?
Yes.
Do you think that's possible?
No question. I think childcare in the workplace really is one of the answers. We've got a creche, you know, in Westminster now. Mm-hmm. People can leave their babies there in Westminster in a nursery. It used to be a shooting gallery, I think, and it's now,
it's changed.
And there are many more women. I mean, absolutely remarkable. Yvette Cooper, you know, the Labour Party, she's the Home Office spokesperson at the moment. I mean, Shadow Secretary of State for the Home Office in the Labour Party. She's had three children since she's been in Parliament. She went into the House of Commons the same time as me in 97. She had three children. And, wow. You know, they're quite old now. I did it the other way around because the opportunities weren't there for me, being a different generation. But I found that my life since my children have become independent has been hugely fulfilling and very interesting, and some might say successful in the traditional sense. And that's all happened from my mid-50s onwards, you know. And that's the other advantage you must always remember about being a woman. And I know I'm being very upbeat about this, but you have to be. Women live longer than men.
Yeah.
On the whole, they're healthier than men. We have better health care in this country anyway. Not in other countries, but we do in this country.
Which is like more positive.
Yeah. So actually, women live longer than men.
Hopefully we'll be more successful then in that case.
And we can, don't discount age. Older women have a huge amount to offer.
Hopefully they do. But when it comes to like bringing the creche, for example, to the workplace, is that something that the females, for example, in a certain company can ask the...
Well, they ought to really start working on it within their company, shouldn't they? Don't you think?
Yeah.
You know, sometimes we need to take the initiative ourselves. MPs certainly did and said there's got to be some facility.
Do you think the next... party would be able to also introduce that into the UK?
Be nice to think so. Go and find your MP, go and find your political representatives and question them about it.
Yeah,
what are you going to do about opportunities for women? I mean, it would be a good idea in the run-up to the general election. You can put people on the spot, put people who are standing for election on the spot, put the existing MP on the spot and ask them what they're going to do about these issues.
But sometimes, like when thinking about it, you know, like this, the current government, they said that they weren't going to be increasing university fees. However, they did, regardless of how many, what that they said and how many people
disaster.
Protested. But it still took place. So sometimes it's like when they promise something, they don't actually fulfil it.
No. But you have to accept that. That mustn't stop you nagging them and nagging them and nagging them. And I think a lot of the faults in our country at the moment is because people aren't active enough. They don't nag their representatives enough. They think, oh, I know, it'll all happen now, you know, I'm comfortable enough. And they open another packet of crisps and sit in front of the television. And, you know, that's not the right attitude. You've got to go for it, go out there and fight for things.
Hopefully more people would actually fight for it because it would help.
Yeah.
Not just yourself, but so many
and
others.
And the women are the best equipped because they've got the best background. They know what's going on. They know what's going on in society, in the schools. I've said that before. And that's why, incidentally, we haven't mentioned it, that I am so upset and worried about child marriage and people being married before, you know, and pinned down before they're actually mature enough physically or mentally to have done anything.
It's not just marriage. Like, in the UK, you've got lot of 16-year-olds and, you know, like 18-year-olds which are have more than one child, and it's really surprising.
It's just appalling. It's appalling.
Like when I was in year 10, for example, we had more than one girl
really?
In our year that was pregnant, and we were just all surprised because it's like, you know, you expect in the UK for, you wouldn't really expect that much in the UK because it's like, you know, we've got a lot of opportunities to do better.
I don't defend that in any way. I think it's appalling. But one of the reasons it's happened is we've had very, very, very poor sex and relationships education in the schools. And a lot of parents are not equipped to give it. And so the girls just, you know, are totally ignorant. They don't realise what are they letting themselves in for. And they think it's cool. You know, if you, one of the things that I actually admire about your culture more than our culture is that our culture, it seems to have gone degenerate. You know, it wasn't like that when I was younger. Everything you look at has sexual images. You know, there are people dress, I don't advocate everyone dresses as you do, although you look beautiful the way you do. But, you know, some of them go around with hardly any clothes on at all. Yeah. And I just find, am I old-fashioned? What is it? I just find if people are surrounded by sex and sexual images, and you see all these film stars going around, and even when they're pregnant, they're proudly flaunting the fact, their bump, they call it. Mm-hmm. And it looks like that's the cool thing to do. That's what everyone wants to do. But what we need to show these girls is that life as a single mother with one or two children, whether you look cool when you're pregnant with your bump, just like Angelina Jolie or whoever it is, that's not real life. Real life is very, very tough once you start getting pregnant and having babies. Actually, effectively, if you haven't got a good enough education and a means to promote yourself, your life is over from then on.
Thank you very much. There are so much more questions that we would have loved to ask you, but we've run out of time. Hope to see you soon and watch us again on Beneath the Surface.